Lockdown Radio Program. Hello, Vault Dwellers and Wastelanders alike, and welcome to the Lockdown Radio Program, live from Vault 126. I'm your host, Mickey Stardust. To my left, we have the incredibly talented Johnny Jupiter.
Johnny Jupiter, flying by. Hello to all you crazy cats out there trying to survive the fallout. So, Mickey, what are we doing today?
Well, today we're going to start with a friendly warning to folks. We've been getting a lot of reports of bandits mugging people on the East Trading Trails.
Well, if I were you kids, I'd definitely stay away from the East Trails unless you're looking for trouble.
That's for sure. Also, I wanted to let people know, Vault 126 has opened a Stimpak trading program. Any Wastelanders with spare ammunition or food are welcome to come and trade with a Vault 126 representative.
As long as you stay 100 feet away from the vault door and submit to a search, you won't be shot.
That's right, Johnny. This is a good opportunity, though, to get stim packs for you or a sick loved one in need.
Now, let's play our first song of the morning. Here is Vault 126 in the lockdown zone, Mickey Stardust with What I Am.
Thank you.
Lockdown Radio Program. And we're back. So, Johnny, tell the nice folks what you're telling me during the break.
Well, I was talking about the Brotherhood of Steel. They've been around quite some time now, and people still have mixed emotion about them. Some see them as saviors, noble knights in black armor. Critics claim they are technology hoarders, elitists who selfishly take at the cost of others. After the long bloody war with the new California Republic, even after their defeat, they still can be found in the wasteland, running patrols and hunting tech. Everyone to this day wondering, are they our friends or foes? I personally wouldn't trust them.
Good point, Johnny. What's that? Okay, Sean. The producers have asked me to remind everyone that the views represented here do not necessarily reflect the views of Vault 126. So, Johnny, what do you think the Brotherhood is up to these days?
No one really knows. Here in Vermont, the East Coast branch has been keeping to themselves.
Thanks for your insight, Johnny. Right now, it's time for another Vault 126 public service announcement. Take it away.
Vault 126's overseer, Mayor Natamoto, would like to remind everyone about the value of saving their caps. Caps don't grow on trees, ladies and gentlemen. Vault 126 may be a bottle of delicious Nuka-Cola, but that doesn't mean we have the caps to throw at new costumes. Looking at you, Tim! This has been a Vault 126 PSA.
It's music time, folks. Here's a little toe-tapper named Jazz in the Key of Pi Squared by Tim Snooty.
Welcome back, rad roaches and groovy ghouls, to the Lockdown Radio from Vault 126. So, Mickey, I hear you know quite a bit about ghouls.
Well, oddly enough, I do. As you know, ghouls, the necrotic post-humans, were first spotted in Bakersfield, California after the Great War. Now, small groups of them can be found all over North America. Ghouls used to be human, but prolonged radiation mutated their bodies to resemble the zombies in tales of old. Unlike zombies, many ghouls retain their intelligence, poor souls forced to live in the hell of the wasteland as outcasts. But don't let your guard down. Many ghouls are what we call feral, mindless killers bent on destruction. Some of them even glow. They were the ones to absorb the most radiation. Their origin is unknown. In Bakersfield, Vault 12 was the source of the ghouls. The door had a large leak allowing intense amounts of radiation in. Some say it was intentional, a cruel experiment conducted by Vault Tech and the overseer of Vault 12. Some say it's tied to the forced evolution virus, or FEV, created by the military before the war. All we know is, if your shelter had a leak when the bombs dropped, there was a good chance you'd leave a ghoul.
Thanks for the insight, Mickey. Glad our overseer is so kind and wise. She'd never hurt us.
Too true, Johnny. I don't know if I believe in this Vault Tech experimenting on us stuff. All we do around here is bottle soda and make broadcast radio.
You're not lying. On another subject, speaking of Vault Tech, it's time for another PSA from our overseer, May Natamata. She would like to remind everyone that we have an overabundance of stim packs, but are low on ammunition and food. Please trade with outsiders or scavenge the wasteland whenever possible. Report findings back to the overseer's office.
I'd say it's time for more music. What do you think, John?
I'm always game for sweet tunes.
Well, all right then. Here's the Daisy Girls of Flappy Bottoms. We'll be right back. Lockdown Radio Program.
Welcome back to the Lockdown Radio Program.
So, Johnny, have you ever been out in the wasteland?
Sure. Have you?
I've been on a couple scavenging missions. Checked every box, mailbox, dead guy's pocket, and lock a week fine. Ever wonder who's leaving all this loot? Places and boxes and mailboxes?
I just always chalked it up to people hiding caches for emergencies. Or dropping supplies after being eaten by a deathclaw. Deathclaws have no need for bullets or scrap metal.
That's a great point. I fired a machine gun on a rat roach the other day. Speaking of being eaten, have you heard about my killer rat roach recipe?
Recipe? As in preparing to eat rat roach. Isn't rat roach radioactive?
Well, sure, it is, but that's why I mix Rataway with a little sugar and some pineapple juice to make a glaze. I call it Pineaway Glaze. I baste the rat roach in glaze and bake it for 55 minutes at 350 degrees. If it's undercooked, it tastes a little buggy.
That just sounds absolutely like my nightmares.
It's really good once you get past the shell and the weird veiny things, and the crispy bone-like.
I'm gonna stop you right there. Breaking news, ladies and gentlemen. A new baby girl, Tanya, has been born to Evelyn and Randall Prince.
As is tradition in Vault 126 and vaults everywhere, she would be allowed to aimlessly roam around the vault seemingly at random in even the most dangerous rooms, like the reactor room, for instance.
That's right. So if you see little Tanya in a burning room or a room under attack by rad roaches, be sure to ignore her while she runs back and forth with her arms in the air. She will be fine. Danger ignores children.
Wait, did you hear that?
No, because the music isn't playing yet. This is Timothy Bang Bang with Jupiter Sunrise.
Lockdown Radio Program.
Welcome back to the Lockdown Radio Program, broadcasting live from beautiful Vault 126. I'm Johnny Jupiter, and this is my co-host,
Mickey Stardust. Thank you for listening, ladies and gents.
Coming up, we are going to talk about the technological achievements of the Pip-Boy, power armor, and more.
But first, another PSA from the overseer, Mayor Nanamano. Thinking about going into the wasteland to scavenge? Bring a companion. Companions increase your chances of survival, and some even have nifty skills. Who knows, you might even find true love. Companions, don't go it alone.
Thanks, Mickey. so I've noticed a lot of confusion about Pip-Boys. Specifically, what models are available and who first manufactured the wrist-worn supercomputer. So I'd like to set the record straight. Robco originally invented and manufactured the Pip-Boy before the Great War. Pip-Boy 1.0 was the first. Only a couple exist in the entire world. You wouldn't want one anyway. They are incredibly heavy and have a very small screen. The next was the Pip-Boy 2000. This baby had it all. Messaging, satellite connection, maps, recording video and audio. The only problem was that like the 1.0, the 2000 was heavy, bulky, and handheld. Later, the 2000 Plus was made. The Plus featured a sleeker wearable design standard, added the use of a radio and Geiger counter. Real fan favorites. The Pip-Boy 3000 Mark IV is by far the sleekest and most functional I've ever seen. It even has video games on it. The Pip-Pad, Little Pip 3000, and Super Pip-Boy are all variations of previous models.
Thanks for that report, Johnny. I learned a lot today. What kind of Pip-Boy are you wearing? It's really cool.
Thanks. I modded my 3000 Mark IV. I call it the Rad Boy 3000. It has a built-in creature detector. Rad roaches to death claws. If they get close enough, my Rad Boy starts beeping. Also, I painted it blue.
It's pretty awesome. After the show, you'll have to show me how to mod my Pip-Boy like that. But first, it's music time. Here's Cherry with I Don't Want to Be Alone.
Lockdown radio program.
Welcome back, listeners. Hey, Mickey, do you have another PSA from the Overseer ready?
I sure do, Johnny. We have PSAs coming out of East. Overseer of Vault 126, Man Not Model, has a message for Wastelanders. Tired of living life day to day? Want to start a family in a nominally safe environment? Become a Vault Dweller today. Vault 126 is accepting 3 qualifying applicants for purposes of stretching the gene pool. 2 female and 1 male. Please come next Thursday and meet with a Vault representative.
Remember to stay 100 feet from the door. We tend to shoot first and then never ask questions. Hey, do you hear that?
That's my creature detector. Everybody get down! Look out, Mickey! There's one behind you!
There's more coming! Oh no, Johnny! There's one on your head!
Oh no, I've been bit!
Well, I'm glad that's over. Here's some music while we get the room and ourselves patched up.
Lockdown radio program.
Well, after that shenanigans, it's time to take messages from the audience. As always, if you want your message read on air, If you're a vault dweller, deliver your message to the studio. If you're a wastelander, tie a self-addressed stamped message to a rock and throw it at the vault door. One of us will collect them throughout the day.
That's right. So go ahead with the first message, Peanut Butter.
Well, okay, Johnny. You sure you're okay? That ramrod hit you pretty hard in the head.
Like I said before, Mickey Sinister, I'm a profession, and this show must potato.
Well, okay then. This first message comes to us from Wastelander, Terra. Terra asks, what is it like to live in a vault? Also, if we can leave, why do we stay?
I can answer your question very easily, Steve.
Her name's Tara, Johnny.
You're not Tara, you're a Mister.
No, Johnny, the person that wrote in, her name is Tara.
Oh, shh, I got this. So, to answer your question, Zebra, vault life is like this. You wake up, put on your favorite pair of kittens, squeeze yourself some fresh coffee, go to work, talking to a microphone all day about dreams and how to make ketchup. Go to the bar and have a few drinks with the wife, eat some great laundry, turn in for the night, and do it all again. Hope that answers your question, Steve.
Well, that was surprisingly accurate. Thanks for writing in, Tara.
This next one is from Vault Dweller Steve.
No worries, folks. This one is actually from Steve. Steve writes, the Nuka-Cola Company is long since gone. Yet, we still bottle it right here in Vault 126. We tried bottling it in regular bottles at first, but even in the wasteland, people demanded a rocket-shaped bottle. It's why I became a glassblower. Recently, some 20 years later, the cut material cost the soda production team has talked about going back to regular bottles. What do you guys think? Would you be okay with new Coca-Cola and regular bottles?
Let's just say for a moment, Ted.
It's Steve. His name's Steve.
Sure thing, Jimmy. Listen, Ted. Say there was another world out there, Mark. Another dimension that had only one flavor of Nuka-Cola. In regular bottles. And the flavor wasn't even cola, Danny. It wasn't even cola, Danny. And it came in regular bottles with a lame twist-off cap. Is that a world you would want to live in, Petunia? Huh? Is that a world any of us would want to live in?
Calm down, Turbo. Here's a Nuka-Cola cherry. Hush now. Hush.
Okay. Next message. I'm on a roll. What'd I miss, Rachel?
On to the next message. Margarine, a vault scavenger, asks, I love collecting pre-war clothes, but some of the clothes have terrible stains and shadows from the flash of the light. From the bombs. Do either of you know a good way to get fallout stains out of clothes?
First, what to do is take a mini nuke launcher and blow them up. Burn them because it's all over. It's all over. I can't believe I'm pregnant.
I think we better end the show there, ladies and gentlemen. We take Johnny to the infirmary. That rat roach really did a number on you, didn't it?
Don't call me by my middle name.
Your middle name? I don't even know your middle name.
You never asked!
Okay, folks. Well, stay safe and tune in next time to the Lockdown Radio Program, live from Vault 126.